Hello everyone, in this video we will be taking the GATE 2006 questions, and all these GATE 2006 questions are from the chapter Network and the Transport Layer. So let us discuss about the GATE 2006. Before this we have already discussed GATE 2003, GATE 2004 and GATE 2005 questions. Now this is GATE 2006. Now they are saying which of the following statement is true. Number 1. Both Ethernet frame and IP packet include the checksum field. Number 2. Ethernet frame includes a checksum field and IP packet includes a CRC field. Number 3. Ethernet frame includes a CRC field and IP packet includes a checksum field. And number 4. Both Ethernet frame and IP packet includes CRC field. Now to solve this kind of questions, you should remember the header format of Ethernet, as well as you should also remember the header format for an IP packet. So in case of Ethernet frame, we have the following header format. So this is representing the header format. So first of all, we should have a destination address, and this destination address field is basically going to carry the MAC addresses. So this destination address field is 6 byte field, because as you know, what is the length of MAC address? MAC address is a 48 bit address. So we have destination address, and then we have source address. Again, this source address field is also going to carry a MAC address, so therefore it is also of 6 bytes. And then we have length or the type, or the type of this frame. So this is of 2 bytes. And then we have all the data that this frame is going to carry, or you can say the padding. Now this data and padding, it is maximum of 1500 bytes. This is the maximum length, and in minimum it is of 46 bytes. So generally this data and padding, this field is also called as MTU, that is a maximum transmittable unit. Okay, this is the MTU. And after this we have the CRC, and this CRC is of 4 bytes. So this entire Ethernet frame from here to here, this entire Ethernet frame, the minimum length of this Ethernet frame can be 512 bits, or you can say 64 bytes, and the maximum length of this Ethernet frame can be 1518 bytes. Okay, so this is your Ethernet frame, header format of this Ethernet frame, and this Ethernet frame contains CRC. But when we discuss about this IP packet, now this IP packet, IP header is having various fields. For example, here we have a version field. After the version field, we have a header length field. Then we have type of service field, and then we have total length field, and then we have the identification field. So after this identification field, we have a field which is for flags, and after this flags we have an offset field, and then we have the third row, and this third row is having the field like time to live, protocol that is used. It is also having the header checksum, and then it is having the source IP address, and then it will be having the destination IP address, and then we have some options and padding. So if you look at these two frames, though, this is representing your IP header, and that second one, this is representing your Ethernet frame. Now if you see here, in the IP header we use the header checksum field, but whereas in Ethernet we use the CRC, that is cyclic redundancy check. Now in this question they are asking which of the following statement is true. So we know that Ethernet frame includes the CRC and IP packet include the checksum field. Therefore the correct answer to this question is option number 3. It is a very straightforward and easy question. It's hardly going to take 5 seconds for you to give the correct answer, because you already remember the frame format for Ethernet as well as the header of the IP packet. Okay. Now this is the second question in which they are asking which of the following reasons does internet protocol uses the time to live field in IP datagram. So generally this internet protocol uses TTL field so that we can stop a packet to loop indefinitely throughout the network. Okay, so initially this time to live field was created to have timestamps. But the problem was the timestamp of every device on the network cannot be the same because of various reasons. You cannot synchronize the timestamp of every time of every device on the internet, because even if you want to synchronize the time, then again there will be some kind of latency in signal traveling. So we change this timestamp field to time to live field, that is TTL field, and we use this TTL field so that we can stop any packet to be there in the network indefinitely. So option number one saying ensure packets reach the destination within that time, that is wrong. Option number two, discard packets that reach later than the time, that is also wrong. Prevent the packet from looping indefinitely, this is correct. And option number four, the limit the time for which the packet gets queued in the intermediate wrong node, that is also wrong. So correct answer for this question is option number three. Now let us next question here. And this question is also from Gate 2006. It is asking, a router uses the following routing table. This is the routing table given. A packet bearing a destination address of this arrives at the router. On which interface will it be forwarded? So the IP address is 144, destination address 144.16.68.117. So we will take all these subnet masks and we will do bitwise AND of the subnet mask, and then we will compare with this destination address. For example, the first subnet mask is 255.255.0.0. If you do a bitwise AND of this, so you will get 144.16.0.0 because this is the network ID. Now you can see this network ID is exactly matching with the first entry. But again, let us look at the second entry here, because it might happen that we'll be having subnetting. So here you can see the third octet is having some value. So third octet is having a value which is 224. So take this IP address, which is 144.16.68. So you have to convert this 68 in binary. So this is 0100. Then we have 0100. So this is your 68 in binary. Then we have 117. I just converted the 68 so that we need this. And take this second network mask, which is 255.255. And here we have 224, and you have to convert this 224 in terms of binary. Okay, so that we can easily solve this one. So how this 224 is converted in terms of binary? So that is 128 plus 64. So 128 plus 64 is 192, plus if you add 32 to this, so this will become 4, this is 2, and this is 2. So that means we have 111000. This is 224 in binary, and then we have 0 here. So if you do a bitwise AND here, so we'll get 144.16. Now here, after doing the bitwise AND, only this bit will be 1, otherwise every other bit will be 0. So this bit is representing 64. So this is 64.0. Okay. So you can clearly see this is also matching with this. So that means we have done subnetting here. So might be this is the correct answer, but let us again check the other masks also. So next one here we have 144.16. This is let us just write this up, 68.117, and here the mask is 255.255.255.0. If you do a bitwise AND, then you will get 144.16.68.0. So again, this is having much more depth as compared to the previous one. Okay, and this is also exactly matching. Now let us take the last option here. So we'll check out the last option. Fine. So in the last, we have to open the last one, right? So we have 144.16.68.117. So how do you write 117? So 117 is 64, so subtract 64 plus 32, which is going to be how much? 96. And if you add 16 with this, so this is going to be 2, 10, and this is 11. So 112, right, plus 3. So we need 64, 32, 16, and 3. So this is 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, This is 0, right? And here we have 255.255.255. Here we have 224. So 224 is 111000000. If you do a bitwise AND, then you will get 144.16.68. And here how many bits are matching? So these two bits are exactly matching. So these two bits are representing 64 plus 64, it is 96. So this is not matching with this. Now you can see clearly that this is also matching. This is also matching. This is also matching. But here, because the subnet mask is having greater value here, so that means we must have done subnetting. And because we have done subnetting, so the packet will, even if all these addresses are matching, but still the packet will go to the smallest subnet. So here to this particular interface, which is Ethernet 2, the packet will be forwarded. Okay, so here the correct answer is option number C, that is the Ethernet 2. Okay, now let us look at the next question here. So the next question, they are saying, suppose that it takes 1 unit of time to transmit a packet of fixed size on a communication link, and the link layer uses a window flow control protocol with a window size of n packets. Each packet causes acknowledgement or a negative acknowledgement to be generated by the receiver, and the acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement transmission times are negligible. So we have transmission time of acknowledgement is negligible, but transmission time of data is 1 unit, because they are already giving us the transmission time of data. Now further, the round trip time on the link is equal to n units. So RTT given is n units. Consider that I is greater than n. If only acknowledgements have been received till time I, there is no negative acknowledgement, then the good put evaluated at the transmitter at time I in the packets per unit time is. So for solving this question, first of all, you should know what is a good put, and then you should be able to visualize this entire question. You cannot solve this question just going directly without knowing the concept. So these kind of questions need concepts. Okay, so let's elaborate and explain this question once. So assuming that this is the sender and this is representing the receiver. Now they are saying it takes 1 unit of time to transmit a packet. So first of all, you are going to transmit a packet. So this takes 1 unit of time, right? And the link layer uses a window flow control with a window size of n. Window size of n means initially you are going to transmit all these like this, total n packets, and to transmit all these n packets you need n units of time. Fine. So these packets will be traveling to the receiver. So these packets here, they will be traveling to the receiver, and so on like this. Okay, now in this question they have also given us what is the round trip time, right? So somewhere here let me just show you. So there's a thing, the round trip time on the link is equal to n unit. So here round trip time is n unit. So that means the traveling time from here to here, this is total of n units. Okay, fine. So window size also n, and round trip time is also n. Now they are saying, if only acknowledgement have been received till time I, so till time I, there is only acknowledgement received, right? So if only acknowledgement have received till time I, so because we have transmitted total n packets, for all these n packets there should be some acknowledgements. So here we should know that if the total time here, I mean till time I, from time starting to this time, we have a total time of I. For this time I, there's some acknowledgements have been received. Now because there's some kind of acknowledgement have been received, then how many packets the acknowledgements are not received, that is I minus n. For these many packets the acknowledgements are not received, or you can say these are extra time. So if you understand it clearly, again you can read the question. They are saying, let me rub it and explain to you again. So they are saying that this is a sender and this is a receiver, and the transmission time at the sender side is 1. Okay, and they are saying we use window flow control with a window size of n. That means we have to transmit total of n packets from sender to the receiver. Total we have to send n packets. But they are also telling us that each packet causes acknowledgement or negative acknowledgement. The transmission times are negligible for acknowledgement. The round trip time on the link is equal to n. So round trip time is also n. So that means from here to here, getting an acknowledgement for a packet is also going to take n units of time. And okay, and window size is also n. So that means till this n unit of time, we are sending total of n packets like this. We are sending all these n packets. Okay, we are sending all these n packets. Now for these n packets, we are also getting acknowledgements, correct? So for the first packet, we got acknowledgement. For the second packet, we got acknowledgement. For the third packet, we got acknowledgement. For some packets, we got acknowledgements. Okay, now they are saying round trip time on the link is equal to n. Consider a time I which is greater than n. So we have a time I which is greater than this time n. This is a time I. If only acknowledgement have been received till time I, only till time I the acknowledgements have been received, there is no negative acknowledgement, then the good put evaluated at the transmitter at time I. So what is the good put evaluated at time I? Now for this, as I told you, you should know what is a good put. So good put is basically, it is an application level throughput. We have a term which is called as throughput, and good put is also throughput. It is also throughput, but it is the number of useful information bits delivered by the network to certain destination per unit time. So let me just write it down. It is number of useful information bits delivered by the network to certain destination per unit of time. Okay, so here we only check for the successful delivery of the packets. Okay, now here you can see total. So this is good put. You can also calculate it as good put. You can also calculate it as successfully delivered data. Successfully delivered data divide by the total time. Okay, so here how many data is successfully delivered? So in n units we did n transmissions, but we got acknowledgement for this time, because this is for this much time we got acknowledgement, which is I minus n. So here we got acknowledgements, which is these many acknowledgements we got, divide by this is the total time. So hence if you check it, it is 1 minus n upon I. So if you check these two statements, this is showing this, the first numerator is showing the acknowledgement of successfully delivered data, successful delivered data, and this is the total time. So if you check in the options, so it is matching with the option number 1. So option number A. I hope that you understood this question. Let us move on to the next question now. So the next they are saying, a link of capacity 100 Mbps is carrying traffic from a number of sources. So we have a total bandwidth of 100 Mbps. Each source generates an on-off traffic stream. When the source is on, the traffic rate is 10 Mbps. When the source is off, the traffic is 0. So that means this is sender. I mean, this is some kind of links. Now in this link, sometime the sender want to send the data, so that time is called as on time, and sometime the sender do not want to send the data, that is called as a off time. So we have a on time as well as we have a off time. Now they are saying the ratio between the on off time is 1:2. That means out of 3 units of time, only 1 unit of time we are sending the data, and then 2 units of time we are not sending the data. Okay, for any single, you know, sender. When there is no traffic at the link and the minimum number of sources that can be multiplexed on the link so that link capacity not wasted and no data loss occur is S1. So S1 is the minimum number of sources that can be multiplexed. This is the minimum number of sources that can be multiplexed on the link so that no capacity is wasted, assuming that all sources are synchronized, that the link is provided with a large buffer and the maximum number of sources that can be multiplexed so that no data loss occurs. So they are saying at minimum how many of these sources can send the data, and at maximum how many of these sources can send the data. Okay, a very straightforward question. So you can see the total capacity of the link is 100 Mbps. When you want to send, what is the minimum number of sources? Minimum number of sources. So minimum number of sources will be when all the sources are simultaneously sending the data, and one source require 10 Mbps bandwidth. So let us suppose the minimum number of sources are n. So 10 into n should be less than or equal to 100. Okay, so we can say that n should be less than or equal to 100 divided by 10. So that means equal to 10. That means minimum number of sources, I mean when all the sources are sending the data simultaneously with the link, that is going to be 10. And when I say maximum number of sources, that means these sources are multiplexing. That means, for example, source S1 is first sending the data, then it is going silent, then source S2 can send, then source S3 can send. So you can say in 3 units of time, three sources can send the data, because there's a duty cycle which is 1:2. So when we say maximum number of data, that maximum number of data will be dependent on that duty cycle. So this maximum number of data, you can see in let us say in this case, this 10 Mbps bandwidth can be utilized by three sources, plus again 10 Mbps bandwidth can be utilized by three sources, up to so on, and these many n stations can be there. So this should be less than equal to 100 Mbps. So we can say here that we have 10 into n divided by 3 should be less than equal to 100. So we can say n should be less than equal to 300 divided by 10, which is equal to 30. So maximum 30 sources can send the data. So correct answer to this question is option number A, that is 10 by 30. So again, let me repeat it. If you do not understand it, do not worry why I'm saying this one. See, you must have studied a concept where we can multiplex a bandwidth. For example, this is your 10 Mbps bandwidth. This is your 10 Mbps bandwidth. Now in this 10 Mbps bandwidth, they are telling us that the ratio is 1:2. That is, the for example, this is the hosts. So here this first host can send the data, and when it is off, then second can send the data. When it is off, then third can send the data. So they are telling us that out of 3 units of time, out of 3 units of time, a host is sending maximum of 1 unit of time data, and rest 2 units of time it is sitting idle. So they are saying what is the minimum number of hosts that can send the data, that can be connected, and maximum how many can be connected. So minimum is when all the hosts are sending the data simultaneously at the same time. So that is going to be 10, because we have 100 Mbps bandwidth. So 100 divided by 10 is 10 only. So 100 Mbps of bandwidth, and one source can utilize 10 Mbps of bandwidth. So minimum is 10 sources can send the data. Maximum is when all these sources decide to share the link. So in a perfect condition, they will be using this kind of scenario. So that means within 3 units of time, we can 3 sources can send the data. So if 3 sources can send the data, so this number can be multiplied to 3. So this is going to be 30 sources. Okay. Again, if you do not understand it, just let me know. I'll explain it again. Now let us look at the next question here. A subnetted class B network has a following broadcast address. It's subnet mask. So we have the broadcast address here, and you can see this is a directed broadcast address. So in the directed broadcast address, we make all the links, all the host ID bits as 1. So this is a class B network. In a class B network, only first 2 octets are used for network ID, and the rest of the octet is used for host ID. So just look at this one. So we have also done subnetting in this. That means we must have used some extra bits from this. So here we have 144.16.95. So let us write this 95 in binary. So that is 0101111. Okay, so this is representing the number 31. This is representing number 64.255, which is 11111111. So this is your IP address. Now they are saying which of the following can be a subnet mask. So the first option here is 255.255.224. So 224 means we have done subnetting. So first two is 255, obviously in all the cases 255 will be there. So in 224 can be written as 11, that is 128 plus 64 plus 32. So 100000. Okay. So this can be subnet mask. That means these three bits we have used in the network ID. That means we created 8 subnets. In the second case, we are using 240. So 240 means we have 11110000. That means we have used the first 4 bits here for the network ID. And 248 means we have 11111000. So that means we have used the first 5 bits as the subnet ID. Now here we do not know how many subnets we have created. So any of these subnet masks can be used, because we are not sure that we know that till this, at least this much bits are used for, this is at least these many bits. How many bits are this? 8 and 3. So at least 8 plus 8 is 16 plus 3 is 19 bits are used for network ID, and there can be more number of bits. So at least 19 can be used. We can also have 20, we can also have 21, we can also have 22, we can also have 23, we can also have 24, up to so on, right? So we do not know how many subnets are created. So the first option is saying that we have used total 19 bits. This is saying 19 bits are network ID. The second option is saying we have used 20 bits as network ID. And third option, we are saying that we have used 21 bits as network ID. And any one of them can be true, because we do not know how many subnets are there. Therefore, the correct answer is option number D, could be any one of each of the following. Okay. Now, this is a very beautiful question. And it was also asked repeatedly again. This question is very, very easy. So they are saying there are two computers, that is C1 and C2. There are two computers. C1 has the IP address, which is 203.197.2.53. And network mask of this one, C1 is having a network mask which is 255.255.128.0. And they are saying C2 is having IP address, that is 203.197.75.201. And it is having the network mask, as 255.255.192.0. They are saying which of the following is statement is true. So C1 and C2 both assume they are the same network. C2 assumes C1 the same network, but C1 assumes C2 is on a different network. C1 and C2 is on the same network, but C2 assumes C1 is on different network, and so on. Okay. So how do they check? Actually, the way of checking is that C1 will take its network ID. C1 will take its network ID, and then it will take C2 and it will do bitwise AND with its network mask. So you'll get the network ID. If their network IDs are matching, then C1 will assume that C2 is in the same network. I mean to say, take C1 IP address here. C1 IP address is 203.197.2.53. And network mask of C1 is 255.255.128.0. Now do a bitwise AND. So after bitwise AND, you will get 203.197.0.0. So this is the network ID of C1. Now take C2's IP address, that is 203.197.75.201, and take the network mask of C1. So that is 205.255.255.128.0. Okay. Now perform a bitwise AND, then you will get 203.197.0.0. Now you can clearly see here that if we have used the network mask of C1 and their network IDs are actually exactly matching by using the network mask, therefore C1 assumes that C2 is in same network. because their network IDs are matching, we have used the subnet mask of C1. Now, oppositely, let us do for C2 also. Okay. So here in case of C2, C2's ID is 203.197.75.201. And here the network mask of C2 is 255.255.192.0. Perform a bitwise AND here. After performing a bitwise AND, you will get 203.197.64.0. Okay. So this is what C2 is getting its network ID. Now take the IP address of C1. So IP address of C1 is 203.197.2.53. Take the network mask here. So network mask is 255.255.192.0. Perform a bitwise AND between this. So bitwise AND is going to give us 203.197.0.0. So after performing the bitwise AND, you can clearly see that their network IDs are different. Their network IDs are different. Therefore, C2 assumes that C1 is in different network. Is in different network. Okay. So in this question, you can clearly see that C1 assumes that C2 is in the same network, but C2 assumes that C1 is in the different network. So correct answer is option number C in this case. I hope that you understood this question very easily, and it's very interesting question. Again, previous year also, they ask questions based on this concept. It's a very easy question. Okay. Now let us look at the next question. Here they are saying a program on a machine X attempts to open a UDP connection of port this one. Port is 5376 on a machine Y, and a TCP connection to a port 8632 on a machine Z. However, there are no applications listening at the corresponding ports on Y and Z. There's no application, right? So that means the port cannot be opened. So we have to send an ICMP packet. So an ICMP port unreachable error will be generated by both X and Y, because even if it is UDP or even if it is TCP, if the port is not reachable, in that case, we have to generate an ICMP packet, and the ICMP packet will be generated from both the machines. So correct answer is D. Very straightforward. Now till this time, we have discussed gate 2006 questions. Questions till all gate 2006. Now in the next video, we will be discussing about the questions from gate 2007 onwards.